Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty, so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? King of glory, King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Then you would take my place. Then you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, oh God. Then you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy. Worthy, worthy, oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Then you would take my place, oh God. Then you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, that you've done for me. Oh, that you've done for me. Oh, that you've done for me. Like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. And your love is enduring through the winter rain, and beyond the horizon. Mercy for today, faithful you have been. Faithful you will be, you pledge yourself to me. And it's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You father the orphan, your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness, strength becomes on. You're making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes. For you will have your bride, free of all her guilt, rid of all her shame, known by her true name. And it's why I sing your praise. Ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You will be praised. You'll be praised with angels and saints. We sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised with angels and saints. We sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised. Angels and saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised. With angels and saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. And it's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips. Ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips.
Welcome. We're so glad that you're able to join us again this Sunday for another great day of worship. My name is Sarah Palera. I'm the pastor of discipleship here at Bedford Community Church. I have a couple announcements for you of things that are coming up that you might just be interested in. Coming up October 3rd is our last day of camp. Throughout the summer, we've been at Breaker Rock Beach, and we want to invite you and any pre-K through fifth grader that you know to join us October 3rd right here at BCC for our last day on the beach. Then, coming up October 20th, we have Pumpkin Palooza. If you haven't been here for a Pumpkin Palooza, it is a time of pumpkin painting and trunk or treating. It's a great place for you to come and get to know other people here at Bedford Community Church. Other families, your kids can be with other kids, but it's also a great time for you to invite your neighbor to come and join us. We'd love to have your neighbor join us either for worship or just to come for the event after our second service. Again, that's on October 2nd. And finally, coming up on October 26th, we are going to be hosting a Youth Mental Health Advocacy Day. We are welcoming in members of the community, teens, families from all around the surrounding area, and we're going to have important conversations around the state of mental health for our young teens. So what we need from you is we need some people that are willing to volunteer and help prepare a meal that day, and also to help prepare our building for that event. So if you're interested, please contact Danny soon. As always, there are four ways to give here at Bedford Community Church: in person, via the app, online, or through the mail. We're glad that you're here with us this week, and we look forward to seeing you again soon.
Good morning and welcome to Bedford Community Church. I'm so glad that you're here to join us today as we begin a new series that we're calling The Sound and the Fury. I don't know about you, but when I was in high school, I had to take two classes, Brit Lit and American Lit. And those classes for me were not exactly enjoyable at the time. When I was in high school, I wasn't an avid reader. And so Brit Lit and American Lit, oh man, some of those books that we had to go through, the Canterbury Tales, dreadful. We had to look through some of the plays of Shakespeare, and really, I mean, as a high school student, I was not digging it. And then in American Lit, we looked at, we read the Pearl by John Steinbeck and a few other kind of classic books. We read some Walt Whitman poetry and things. But one book that stuck out in my mind was the book by William Faulkner, The Sound and the Fury. This is actually the same kind of copy that I had when I was in high school, same cover and everything. And The Sound and the Fury is an interesting book. It is a book that follows what they call stream of consciousness, and it tells the same story from four different perspectives. And it's kind of a classic in American literature because the way in which the story was told. It's a new and unique way to tell a story from four different perspectives, having this stream of consciousness, this writing that takes place as though you're in the mind of the narrator. And it was really if you got some time, it's an interesting read. But what I learned in my American Lit class was actually that this book title, The Sound and the Fury by Faulkner, is titled after something that comes from British literature. And so if you've read some of Shakespeare's plays, I'm sure you're familiar with Macbeth. And in Act 5, Scene 5, Macbeth uses this term, The Sound and the Fury, in a way that he's describing something. And so I have a special treat for you. We have a member of our congregation, one of our elders, David MacDonald. And if you didn't guess it by the name MacDonald, he is from Scotland. Now, Macbeth takes place in Scotland, and I thought, what better way to hear this quote from William Shakespeare than out of the mouth of a true Scotsman? And so I hope you'll enjoy hearing David read from us from Act 5, Scene 5 of Macbeth.
Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time, and all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
What I love about that quote, and thank you, David, for doing that for us, is that final line where it talks about the author's talking about life. Macbeth is talking about life, and he says that life is full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. Full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. In Scripture, we have an author that writes a similar thing in the book of Ecclesiastes. He says that life, after he explored everything, the highs and the lows of life, he was a king who had wealths beyond measure. He had access to everything. And at the end of his life, the author of the book of Ecclesiastes says that it is vanity. He says, vanity, vanity, all is vanity. This word in Hebrew can be equated almost to the idea of a vapor. If you think of a spray bottle, right? If you've ever sprayed Windex and you see the vapor, you can see the liquid in the base. You know what you're supposed to be containing, but ultimately, when you spray, it just turns to nothing. It dissolves into the air like vapor. And that's what the king in Macbeth was experiencing. He had gone through a great length to become king. If you know the story of Macbeth, or if you don't, if you know the story of the Lion King, they're very, very similar, right? He had killed his own brother to become king, but then as soon as he became king, he was nervous and he thought everyone was out to get him. He had, if you will, the proverbial sword of Damocles sitting over his head. That's Greek mythology. That's freshman high school literature, if you didn't get there. So just making all these references at once. but he was nervous. He had the power, the control, everything that he had worked for, everything that he had aspired for, worked in this cutthroat way to get. And then once he's sitting in the position where he expected everything to be good, all he finds is sound and fury, the world raging against him, and it all ultimately signifies nothing. Well, we're not in a British lit or an English lit class, so why are we talking about this today? Why are we bringing this up in the kickoff of our new series? Well, the reality is, I think in our lives, a lot of us recognize a similar trend to what Macbeth saw, what Faulkner tried to put into his writing, that the events of our lives, while we feel like they are building towards something, that we're looking to gain control or power or even just purpose in a daily experience, it ultimately sometimes feels like it amounts to nothing more than sound and fury. A world raging against us, uncertainty looming before us, and we're left in this position of discomfort, and we feel demoralized like Macbeth does, that ultimately it all signifies nothing. Like the author of Ecclesiastes says, it all results in vanity, in vapor. But the scriptures have something to say about this worldview, about this experience. And we're going to begin now a few weeks' journey looking at the book of Acts. The book of Acts is the story of the beginning of the early church after the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. You see, the disciples, they had followed Jesus around through the Gospels. They had been trying to learn the things that he was teaching. They had tried to instill in themselves some of the characteristics that he was encouraging in them. They had seen great works and signs and wonders. They had expectations and hopes of what the kingdom of God was going to look like. They even had imperial hopes of what it was going to be like for the kingdom of Israel to be restored when this Messiah came. And then Jesus came and he walked to the cross and he died. And in a lot of ways, it seemed like the sound and the fury of the world, the religious empire in the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the political empire in the Romans and the occupying forces, they came against what God was doing, and the sound and the fury came up, and the church, the early church, had to be wondering, does it all just signify nothing? These last 3 years, what we dedicated our life to, is that too just going to go up in vapor into the air? And then something happened 3 days after the cross. Jesus rose again. And when he did, the faith of those disciples was shifted. It was rebirthed, and it was shaped in a new direction where they were no longer so concerned about kingdoms of this world, although we'll see this is a mentality that is hard to break and comes up again and again and again in Acts. But instead, they were starting to learn what it means to wholly put their faith in the person and in the work of Jesus Christ, the one who overcame the grave. Even when the sound and the fury did not diminish, persecution comes in Acts stronger even than before. The occupying forces of the Romans did not lessen after the crucifixion of Christ. In fact, the imperial forces continued to press in against the Christian, persecuting them, scattering them. The sound and the fury was loud. And yet, in spite of that, the early church never got to the point where they said, all of this signifies nothing. They said the opposite. In the person and work of Christ, all of this experience, this pain, this suffering, this hardship, it signifies that God is still on the move. And as we look through Acts, we see time and time again, through the building of his church, through the empowerment of his people, through the commissioning of his workers to the ends of the earth, God is at work doing something new. And it is so significant that it transforms the reality of the sound and fury. And so I encourage you, as we begin this study, as we begin looking at God's word, this week, if you feel like your life is surrounded by sound and fury, if you feel like experiences are pushing you into a point of discomfort where you're wondering, what was the purpose of all this effort, all this achievement, all this striving, all this hardship? Did it all signify nothing? Because sometimes it feels like when we get a certain diagnosis, or when we see a certain struggle in a relationship, when our kids do something particular, or even when they walk away, all that effort was for nothing, vapor into the air. I hope that this series, looking at the book of Acts, can show you that God will use these things, can use and redeem these things, and make it so that in your life, They are significant aspects of the transformative work of God for you. So let's open in prayer, and then we'll look at our scripture for today. Lord, I thank you that you did something new. You rose from the dead, something nobody had done. And then you set apart a people to continue bringing life and wholeness into your world. Lord, I pray for those of us who are experiencing the sound and the fury of the world against us today, that we would be able to look at your word with fresh ears and fresh eyes, that we would see the way you have called and given direction to our lives in the same way you did your early disciples. Lord, I pray that in the reading of your word, you would challenge and transform our hearts. It's in your name we pray. Amen. So we're going to look today, beginning at Acts chapter 1, and we're going to take a few little segments of this scripture up through chapter 12. But I want to first just by starting to look at Acts chapter 1, verse 1 through 3, the introduction to this book. And the author says, "In the first book, O Theophilus, I dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up. After he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen, he presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God." We'll stop there for a minute. The author of this book, to give us some context, is Luke the physician. We know about him from other New Testament books. He was a journeyman, a missionary along with the apostle Paul. And he wrote two books of the New Testament. He wrote this book of Acts, and the book of Acts is a sequel to the book of Luke, the one named after the author. In the book of Luke, we see that that Luke is writing again to this person, Theophilus. I'll read it for you. In the beginning of Luke chapter 1, it says, "Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished amongst us, the disciples, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word have delivered them to us, it seemed good to me also, having followed all these things closely for some time in the past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things about which you have been taught." Read that last section again. "I wrote this orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things that you have been taught." Both the book of Acts and the book of Luke are addressed to this person, Theophilus, or most excellent Theophilus. Theophilus is a Greek name that was common to people that were learned, especially learned in religious things. So likely, using the Greek name for this, Theos, for God, and it comes from the Greek word for love, the same root word that we have in Philadelphia. Filio, a friendship or familial love, a friendship-based love. This was a person whose name meant friend of God. Likely, they were a Greek person that had studied and learned about and knew things about the Hebrew God. The term that the Hebrews would have used for this would have been he was a proselyte, somebody that had learned about the Jewish God and the customs and maybe come to believe. And Luke writes a special account for him about all the things that Jesus had done in the Gospel of Luke, and then continues on to write all the things that Jesus continues to do through his Spirit and the working of the church in Acts. And he writes it for an important reason. It says, that you may have certainty, that you may be certain about the things that happened. And so I just want to encourage you, I don't know where you are on your faith journey or what you've been told about the scriptures, but they have been written for a purpose. And that purpose is so that you may have certainty about who God is and what he has done. See, this isn't just a whole bunch of made-up fairy tales. These aren't fictitious accounts. Luke writes in such a way, he goes about saying, we gathered the eyewitnesses. We got the right stories. We know what really happened, and we verified it against the people that actually lived and experienced it. And I wrote it down so that you can be certain that this took place. And it's such a great thing in the beginning of Acts in verse 3 where it says, he presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them for 40 days. See, Theophilus may be like Some people in our modern world today will say, yeah, Jesus was great. He was alive. He was a good moral teacher. But then he died at the hand of the Romans, presumably. But Acts is saying, and Luke is saying, look, I want you to know with certainty that our Lord rose. He appeared for 40 days and showed people by many proofs. And at the time when Luke was writing, he was pretty much saying, look, you want to know if this is true? Go ask that guy. He's still around. There were lots of eyewitnesses, lots of proofs. And then Luke lays out the orderly account of all the things that transpired after the resurrection of Jesus. And so I'll just to say, when we look at our scriptures, when we look at this Bible, the reason we care so much about what the Bible says is because we believe it is true and it is real and it is important and it is valuable in communicating for us with certainty the way God has acted. And so Luke starts out his narrative of the Acts of the Apostles the same way. And then with this idea in mind to show for Theophilus and show for us what God has done, he continues on in verse 4. What was the first thing that happened? And while staying with them, Jesus that is, while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which, he said, you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they, the disciples, asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes. And they said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you have seen him go into heaven. So what's going on in this passage? Well, we have Luke telling us in the beginning that this was a real account, one that was meant to communicate what actually happened. And then the very first thing that we have is Jesus telling the disciples to do something, and the disciples not quite understanding. This, if you've read through the Gospels, you know is part and parcel to the ministry of Jesus. He would tell people something, especially the disciples, and they would not quite get it right away. And I don't really blame them. You see, if I was with the disciples, I think at this time, I would have expected this to be, the beginning of the book of Acts to be, the superhero moment. See, they already thought that Jesus was going to be the one that would come and to overthrow the Romans, to put back Israel into its former glory, its place in the geographical and national kingdoms of the world. And they had seen Jesus do these amazing things, right? He had fed 5,000 people. Can you imagine a military leader that could snap his fingers and raise up food for an army? They'd be almost unbeatable. Can you imagine a military leader that had the wisdom and understanding of God's law that they could communicate true and right ethics as they establish a new kingdom with them as the helm? Wow, they could lead like no other nation. And now, even when this Messiah, even when this leader is killed, 3 days later, he rises again from the dead, he would be unstoppable. He would be the military leader. He would be the wise king. He would be the one to care for all the people. The Israelites were getting excited. And so Jesus, he tells them in verse 4, he ordered them, do not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father. Don't leave, wait. And then they ask, why? Are you now going to restore the kingdom of Israel? Is now the day when you're going to do what we expected you to do? Is now the day where we're going to see the fulfillment, where the nation's going to rise up again, when things will be put back into right order? Jesus, you overcame the grave. You can do it now. Surely it's the right time. But Jesus says, it's not for you to know the time or the hour. but that is by the Father and His authority. The reality is, I think a lot of us are still asking the same question the disciples did 2,000 years ago. Lord, is now the time you're going to restore the kingdom? Some of us are asking this about the nation of Israel. Lord, is now the time when you're going to restore the nation of Israel? We have an eschatological vision or hope or expectation of what it's going to look like for Israel to be established as a nation. And sometimes I think as believers, people get tired of waiting. And we see, oh man, if you're watching the news this week, like I'm watching the news this week, you're seeing the wars taking place in Gaza and in Palestine and in Lebanon. And there's people hoping and wondering, Lord, is this when you're going to restore your kingdom? And some of us don't even feel quite like waiting. We're edging it on. We're encouraging. We're throwing money behind it. We're throwing support behind it because we got tired of Jesus' answer. It's not for you to know the times or the hours. And so we try and push these things. But it's not just the political kingdom of Israel where we do this. I think so often, more often, it's the building of our own kingdoms. We have our own, just like the disciples did, hopes and dreams and desires of what it would mean to see our kingdoms built in this world. And we come to Jesus and say, look, you can feed the 5,000, you can raise from the dead. Aren't you going to give me my dream now? Aren't you going to build the kingdom the way I want you to, the way I expected you to? And Jesus says, that's not for you to know. In a lot of ways, when I was young, I used to watch The Simpsons. I'm putting that out for you all. You can judge me accordingly. Mom, if you're watching this, I know you told me a million times I wasn't allowed to watch The Simpsons. I did anyway. But there's a scene in The Simpsons when the two younger kids, or the two children, Bart and Lisa, they get into the car, and then the parents get into the car, and as soon as the family pulls out of the driveway and onto the road, as soon as they're like, just starting the journey, wherever they're going. They could be going down the street to like the hamburger joint, or they could be going across the country on some kind of like funny, goofy road trip episode. But as soon as they get in the car, they start going, are we there yet? 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 And Homer, the dad, looks in back, no. Are we there yet? Are we there yet? No. And continually, until they get to wherever they're going. The whole ride is this sequence of just, are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? And in a lot of ways, that's kind of what happens with the disciples and with us when we relate to God and the coming of the kingdom and the expectation that he's going to build into us what we want or what we expect, what we desire to see happen. We come to God and we see what he's done in the past, or we hear the stories, we read the accounts from Luke, and then we show him what we want and we say, are we there yet? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? And Jesus' answer is, no, that's not what this is about. Maybe that's not even where we're going. It's not for you to know. But instead, he gives the disciples and he gives us two statements in verse 4 and verse 8 that both begin with the word but. In verse 4, while he was staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait. But to wait. And then in verse 8, he says, after telling them that it's not theirs to know the time or the hour, he says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit come upon you. He tells them, but wait for the promise of the Father, and but you will receive power from the Holy Spirit. Wait and receive. Wait and receive. Those are the first responses of Jesus in the sound and the fury of life. In the reality where the church, the early disciples, were ready to see a kingdom restored, a battle waged, a new reality put into place that overthrew the Romans, that would have overthrown the Pharisees, that would have taken down all the adversaries. Like Macbeth, they were ready to throw their weight to start a new kingdom, even if it wasn't the right time. And the sound and the fury of the world was coming around them. And Jesus' response isn't go into battle. It's not run and hide. It's neither of those on the pendulum. His response first is wait and then receive. Why? Well, the first reason I think that we see here is that when you wait, Waiting allows for preparation and for provision. Waiting allows for preparation and provision. Actually, this is a scientifically proven fact now, too. There are social sciences and there are social sciences and business management's philosophies around this idea that waiting is actually often the best course of method for moving forward. When we act rashly, when we decide things quickly, we have a much higher propensity to get things wrong because we don't have the right perspective and we don't have the right preparation. If you've ever watched baseball, right? One of the best ways to be a good hitter is to wait as long as possible before swinging the bat, because as you're watching the pitch, you see the ball come in, and the longer you can wait, the more you can identify the spin on the ball, the way it's going to rise or drop, and the more likely you are to get a hit. It's true in business. The longer you're able to wait to make decisions without pushing past a deadline, the more likely you are to take in a broad range of perspectives, to get the best options, and then to make the best decision moving forward. There's power in waiting. And Jesus knew this. The disciples did not. They didn't recognize the thing that they needed was to wait in order to be prepared. We'll look over the next coming weeks as they met together, as they waited for a few days, even just a few days in Jerusalem. They became prepared in a number of ways. They became logistically prepared as they filled in a replacement for Judas, who had betrayed, and brought in another disciple to become an apostle. They became spiritually prepared as they discerned and prayed together, as they became united again. And maybe if you remember, at the crucifixion scene, where were all the disciples? They were scattered. They were afraid. They were apart from one another. They came together and they waited until they had unity and preparation together again. And in that waiting, they were given provision of what they would need for success. The provision comes in the statement of receiving. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And then you will be my witnesses, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. See, when the disciples waited, they had the opportunity to gain power from the Holy Spirit, to receive what was really needed for them to be successful. And when that happens, the reality is that the vision and the scope of their ministry expanded so much more beyond what they had expected. They were looking for the Lord to restore the kingdom to Israel, a small geographical area, not really that much bigger than the size of New Jersey. They were looking for that to be the work of God, that to be the kingdom of God. And maybe without the power of the Holy Spirit, we could establish a small nation state that could hold on against its enemies. Maybe we could fund it enough militarily. Maybe we could create a good enough system of government that lasts for a while. But the plan of God was so much bigger than that for the disciples, and it's so much bigger than that for us today. It's so much bigger than that for you and for your family. It's not just to hold on or to meet your small expectations of what your kingdom can look like. But if you're willing to wait and to receive the power of the Holy Spirit, the result of that is that you will be a witness, not just in a small area, not just Jerusalem, not just a regional area, not just Judea, but into Samaria, across ethnic groups, across geographical groups, and even to the ends of the earth. God has in store something so much bigger if we are willing to wait on Him. But it's hard. Because when we're waiting, oftentimes that is when the sound and the fury of the world seems to rattle the strongest. It's also the place where, like the disciples, we have to die to our own expectations and our own dreams and our own desires. But the story of Acts that we'll see over the coming weeks, that we'll see when we read the scripture, is what God has in store, what God can and will do, is so much greater than what our expectations are for ourselves. And it is so much stronger than the noise and the fury that rattles outside the walls of this church. And so I pray that over the coming weeks, you'll continue to join us, that you'll trust, like Theophilus had to do, the reliability, the truth, the accuracy of these scriptures, and that you will know for certain what God has done and what God intends to do through you. And the first step as a church is to wait. To wait on the Lord, to wait on His power, to wait on His presence, because when we do, we will be given the preparedness and we will be given the provision for all that we need in His kingdom. Let's pray. Lord, I thank You that You are at work in our world. Lord, for some of us, we see a lot of sound and fury. For some of us, that is a diagnosis of a disease. For some of us, it is the call and the temptation to building our own kingdoms, to striving and struggling in this world for achievement, for purpose, for identity. For some of us, it's our families pushing and pulling this way and that. Lord, the sound and the fury is real. And ultimately, Lord, if we lean into that, if we buy into that, like Macbeth, we'll end up saying it signifies nothing. It comes to a meaningless end. Lord, I pray that we would not be found in that position, but instead we would look to the truth of Your scripture, the truth of Your resurrection, and the truth of Your calling to wait on You, to prepare us and to provide for us for what we need to live a godly and holy life of purpose that does not result in vanity or vapor, but instead results in lasting, eternal impact in our lives and to the ends of the earth. It's in Your name we pray. Amen.
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong. Who holds our days within His hand? What comes apart from His command? And what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life. What truth can calm the troubled soul? God is good, God is good. Where is His grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trials, sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore, the rock of Christ. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life. Unto the grave, what will we sing? Christ He lives, Christ He lives. And what a reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with Him. Then we will rise to meet the Lord. Then sin and death will be destroyed. We will feast placed our hope in life and death. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death. Now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death.